Hello, if you are just joining us, this is Level TV, your Pan-African International channel, broadcasting from Libreville, and you are watching the seventh round, the program that takes a look at what makes the news during the week. And in today's episode, we are going to discuss two interesting topics: the exploit of Nigerians outside, the Africans outside the shore of Africans, the case of a Nigerian doctor, Onyema Oyugbo, who has made a history in the COVID-19 vaccine. And thereafter, we'll also talk about sexual and assault on women. But first, we will take the Nigerian doctor exploit on the issue, on the health sector. With me to discuss this program, this topic, is Jean-Michel Bada.
Mr. Willy, thank you for having me. No.
Thank you, you're welcome. And Sidela Nima.
Good afternoon, Mr. Willy, and thank you for having me, and welcome to our viewers.
Okay, we will come back to discuss the program on details after this report.
The United States mission to Nigeria celebrated Dr. Onyema Oyugbo for his role in the development of a COVID-19 vaccine. Oyugbo, who graduated from the University of Calabar in 2003, migrated to the U.S., and rose to become Associate Professor of Medicine and Infectious Disease Specialist at Yale University. He was part of the team that helped pharmaceutical company Pfizer to develop the COVID-19 vaccine. In a Facebook message on Monday, the U.S. mission wrote, "Nigerians contribute to the world in so many ways. Our hats off to Dr. Onyema Oyugbo at Yale University, who helped develop a COVID-19 vaccine." Oyugbo is the son of a former Vice Chancellor of Abia State University, Prof. Stella Oyugbo. He also has a twin brother who is an engineer. The need for a vaccine has become more urgent globally and nationally, with Nigeria recording over 60,000 COVID-19 infections and over 1,000 associated fatalities, according to the Nigerian Center for Disease Control and Prevention, Africa CDC.
That report was by Uche Chinwe, and Dr. Onyema Oyugbo is at the center of Pfizer-led research, development and trial that have culminated in a breakthrough for COVID-19 vaccine. Jean-Michel.
Yes. Well, very big pride for the African continent, of course. We see here that we have a lot to give to the world when it comes to science, and not just our ground, our natural resources, but also our brain. So very happy to hear such news.
Yeah. Asilela, what do you make of that?
Well, as Jean-Michel just said, it's a great pride for the African continent, and especially with the fact that this particular doctor studied in Nigeria, which means that our educational sector is very...
Yes, we will come to that, but let me take you on here. In an interview with ABC News, he said he was super excited by the result because having a very effective vaccine will help in achieving herd immunity. Having a very good vaccine at this time that the world was looking for remedy for COVID-19.
Well, of course, it's great, exactly as you said, because the world is looking for a COVID-19 vaccine. COVID-19 has done such
damage.
How would I say
damage
in the world, with over 1 million or 2 million deaths.
Yes. Yes, Jean-Michel, with Africa being involved in COVID vaccine, do you think this will change African ways of perceiving vaccine produced by Western scientists? Because many Africans do not believe in vaccine at all.
There's a big debate on this, Mr. William. I hope Sidela will agree with what I'm saying here. It's that we're not even sure that it does really exist on the African continent. We think about our climate, feeling like maybe because the death toll is just slightly slower than what we've seen in Europe, maybe we don't need to go for a vaccine. Now, if you want my whole point of view, I'm not being pessimistic here, but when you look at what it takes for a vaccine to be elaborated and be proficient, I don't think it's the right time to talk about a vaccine. I don't think they'll make it right on time.
Yes, the vaccine is the one produced by Pfizer, mm-hmm. which this Dr. Onyema is involved. Yeah. They say it's 90% effective. Sidela, do you look at Africans believing in that vaccine? Because a lot of people have been saying a lot of things about vaccine. The polio vaccine, they say it's not working, it's a way of killing Africans. Is it a way of building trust when we see one of our own involved in it?
I think it's really a way of building trust, because we've seen recently, I think 1 or 2 months ago in Sudan, we've seen a vaccine that was creating a particular disease on children. I don't know if you remember.
Yeah.
So Africa has a really bad relation with vaccines.
Vaccine, yeah.
Yes, we are kind of scared. And I think the way they are putting this Nigerian doctor forward, I think it's a way to build trust.
Yesterday the Madagascar government said they do not want the vaccine, they want to rely on their own COVID remedy.
Yeah. Well, Mr. Willie, when it comes to Madagascar, I mean, clearly this system is really critical. I mean, they came up with the COVID
organics,
I think back in July, but down 2 months later in August, we heard about, I think, 144 people dead. So clearly this thing hasn't been working. I don't know how African stands, like, without a vaccine and without, you know, any drugs. But it's clearly not that COVID organics helping.
In fact, even here in Gabon, I remember as well as there was a doctor that came up and said they've also found a cure for this COVID-19.
Yes, but
when you look at it from the African perspective, don't you think that Africa as a whole can come out with something which can really be a remedy for COVID?
I think we do. With all the biodiversity we have, I think we do. And our researchers just need to be encouraged, because we haven't seen a lot from our governments giving input, giving money, I mean, driving people to that direction. Maybe that's what the African continent is lacking.
Is that the case, the funding in research and other Cidela? Because so far we have 3 vaccines, the one from Pfizer and Moderna, which is Pfizer and Moderna, almost the same percentage. Except the one of AstraZeneca that is 17% and was causing a problem. When you look at it in context of Africa, they're not really started in, at least we only rely on our local remedy. Don't you think government should also fund that area so that we can really fight diseases like this?
Well, yes, obviously the government has not put enough funding.
Definitely not.
For our research, obviously. And that's the reason why. And even when you look at when you look at it globally, I think a vaccine that is coming from Africa will not really
Exactly. Why that perception? Because if Madagascar could be able to come out with something, there was doubt here and there. The World Health Organization said no. The other international community, do you think it was a kind of a plan or a plot not to really accept because it comes from Africa?
It sounded like a plot right at the beginning. And I was part of those people, very optimistic about Madagascar, very proud of them, actually, like an African country standing on its grounds, like promoting what they do. But at the end, it looks like there hasn't really been a scientific work behind this.
What's the scientific word behind it? Because they have their research center.
It's just
which
been
they have
like
been
a
there
plant?
For a long time.
It's just
and has come out with this.
Yeah, I know.
But for instance, because you have the issue of Gabon here, they also had a research center which had come out of it and say, this is what can be done. But it was only in the part of the government to have the political will to say, okay, we are going to test this. Mm-hmm. So what is the problem in Africa not accepting what really is that on when it's come to the medicine breakthrough?
Well, I think what can I say? As you said, the government is rather the politics or the political aspect of it behind the whole research. I would say it like that, yeah.
You see the political aspect of it behind the research, because there's some international pharmaceutical company or other well-established do not want it, would not want it to come out of
this? To my point, it's definitely a political reason behind this. Now we have to locate where it is. Is it our government? Is it a lack of money? Because you need to understand that the pharmaceutical thing, the pharmaceutical industry is a lot of money. We're talking about billions of US dollars here. For an African continent to go into such research, because by the way, it takes round about on average 10 years to have a real good vaccine, an efficient vaccine. So it takes time. It takes time and money. And definitely, I think this is what maybe African governments are not really able to go into, or maybe just don't have the facilities and what it takes, the scientific knowledge.
Okay, let's look at Onyema, the doctor. He graduated, he was a graduate of medicine from University of Calabar in 2003, and now an associate professor of medicine and infectious disease specialist at Yale School of Medicine, United States. What does this tell us about our local university, Sidela?
Well, just the efficiency of our local educational system. We are able to create this kind of mind. But the problem is actually what the government does for them.
What our society does for them. Because he started working at the University of Research Center in his own home state in Nigeria, Abia State. Yeah. His father is a professor, his brother is an engineer. Mm-hmm. He worked in Liberia, he's also worked in Rwanda. Mm-hmm. I think, what does this talk about our university system, our educational system in general in particular?
Our educational system is good, for what we've seen here, Dr. Ogbuagu making African proud, we see that it's good. Now, we need more. You know what I'm saying? We need more. Because if somebody is leaving the African continent, it is a big loss. That is a big loss. And we don't have a lot of minds like this.
It would be a big
continent.
Loss, as you said, because we have so many doctors. Yeah. In my last research, I looked at it, we have more than 7,000 Nigerian medical doctors in the United States alone. When you look at that, and then you look at not only Dr. Onyema, but you have other Africans on all sectors. Mm-hmm. If you go to NASA in the United States, you have all the scientists. What does this talk about? Because if he would have been in Nigeria, probably nobody would have heard about him or anywhere. So what does it say, really, the funding of our university system in Africa?
Well, I think the funding is good. It's just that at the end, people are looking for a best opportunity to put into practice what they've learned at school. And this is where we unfortunately see the brain drain we see. If we have those 7,000 medical doctors on the African continent, it will make a big difference.
But do you think, do you think it's a brain drain or it is where one an environment for one to thrive in? Because we are talking about, we don't have enough a good, if I may say so, of a environment in Africa for scientists to practice, for engineers to practice, because that's why they are moving out of the continent.
Yes, exactly. The environment is the environment. The problem is the environment, because the educational system is not the problem. We've seen it. Yeah. He's the perfect example. But the problem is, as Jean-Michel said, is really a lack of opportunities here on the African continent. Because if he had stayed here, as you said yourself, we wouldn't even have heard about him, yes.
Yeah.
Okay.
Or not being given the opportunity to go on such a research anyway. So this is...
Okay, I think that's it. What do we think government should do in this, if it comes to not only in health? Because if you look at most of the national budget of our country, you look at education will take the least, health will take the least, but other issues that are not even people-oriented, like security, food, and the rest will take much of the, even when money is voted for infrastructure, it is not there. What should government do in this case?
Well, I think probably corruption has something to do with it. I think corruption has something to do with it, because even if they put funding even if the funding is there, then definitely someone is going to
doubt.
Yes. Do you think corruption is affecting the entire system?
Yes, most definitely. But at the end, we need some promotion also from the government and the school ministries, ministers in charge of schools to put our kids where they're supposed to be, in sciences and in medicine, because we do need this, you know what I'm saying? We definitely need this in such situations.
Before we round up this first part, let us look at why students know. Not many students love sciences. Some of them are into a lot of reading courses when they come out. So what do you think makes many students to maybe shy away from sciences?
They're misled, to my opinion. They're just misled. They have to be told what to do in order to thrive themselves, in order to work one day in a proper society, not just go for school because some people go to school for a degree, while people should go to school to add something to the society, to have a work and have a job and add something to the society, not just go for the easiest way, because for some people it's literature seems to be easy, so they just go for the reading, while it's actually not even that easy. So
yes, Elena.
Yes, I think he's right. I think they just go for the easy way, because we tend to think that everything that has to do with literature is easier than science.
Yes,
it's difficult. I think that then we have come to the just the first part of our discussion. Yeah. The Nigerian doctor that had the breakthrough. You have heard it. Our panel have been able to discuss and come out with. Not only going to university to read because you want to read, but go to university, come out and add value to our society. That is what Africa needs. And when we come back, we will look at the second segment of the program. We will talk about the sexual and assault on women. We'll take this after this report.
It's estimated that 14% of Kenyan women aged 15 to 49 have experienced sexual violence at least once in their lifetime. Evelyn Nesha has never depended on anyone to survive, except herself. Together with a group of women, she makes herself peanut butter to feed her family of four. But this is not how it was 5 years ago, when she eventually spoke up on what happened to her. Up to then, she has been a survivor of rape and domestic violence, seeing the perpetrator let loose left her with a permanent wound. But she kept it to herself, afraid of stigma and being shamed, something that is common in her village. Years later, in an unlikely place, she has found solace in a group of women who have all experienced the same predicament of being sexually violated. In the last 12 months, 243 women and girls across the world have been subjected to sexual or physical violence by intimate partner. In the neighborhood like this, sexual and domestic violence was really a taboo. But one woman was willing to change the norm by sharing her story. While Wukanje was a victim of sexual violence, she is now using her experience to remove the stigma and help survivors access psychological and legal help in an informal settlement across Kenya. She went through a traumatic experience when she was raped, and the challenges that she faced during that time is what informed the establishment of the Wakunja Foundation, focusing on how the community looked on a person who have been affected, shifting blames to the one who have been violated instead of holding the perpetrators accountable. Iwangu believes the number of women affected to domestic and social violence could be well about 45%. Working with current numbers, the figures will change because the COVID-19 pandemic created an environment where cases have increased. Now she is hoping to change the narrative and have helped the women set up a peanut butter business and a place to openly talk about their issues.
Okay, as we have heard in that report, the United Nations is going to launch its 16-day worldwide campaign to combat violence against women on Sunday. Today we are going to examine why it is a global problem. Is it one that leaves women in developing countries particularly vulnerable? Here in May, South Sudanese activists protest the gang rape of an 8-year-old girl by the three men while holding her, a mother at gunpoint in the capital, Juba. At the same time, South African President Cyril Ramaphosa declared that the scourge of gender-based violence continues to stalk their country as men have declared war on women. And even in early June, Nigerians started the We Are Tired hashtag campaign after two young women were raped and killed 5 days apart. Late June, campaigners in Sierra Leone protested the rape and killing of a five-year-old girl. In Kenya, more than 3,964 girls become pregnant in 5 months period. Just June and stay at home. And the same story could have also been told in Uganda. We look at all this. United Nations report in Africa are most risk of women. Uche?
I think the United States report on physical and sexual violence on women, I think it's high time they look into it because it's getting out of hand. Our men, in fact, I don't know how to describe them. They are now wolves in human flesh, if I may put it like that. So I think the United Nations should go a long way to look into this and put in some laws to curb these excesses of our men.
Okay, it is in a case of female, excuse me, subjugation being justified as reflecting traditional abuse has become normalized. You see, a normal issue in a society that we should, men should dish out this violence against women, be it assault, be it sexual.
Well, thank you, Mr. Wole, for having me this afternoon. You know, the problem is more deeper than what we are just saying. We have to, educate. Anytime I come around to talk, and anytime I want to talk about something, I put first education in on the table, because we realize that the way we have been educating our young boys is different than the way we have been educating our young girls. When you put in a young man that is superior to a lady, he comes to grown up with a certain fact of being the superhero. He can do whatever he wants to do. So we should redress it. We should put it in a normal way before. And then we see how it goes. And then not only giving some days of working on it, we should daily, I think, yearly working on it. It should be our daily bread to work on people's behavior, to see things changing in the world. Because it has become a worldwide problem. It's not just in Africa. It's not just for people who are poor. But we can say that the reason, the main reason is poverty. Because when people are poor, they don't have food, the brain is also poor.
Okay, the report by the United Nations said that in sub-Saharan Africa as a whole, 23.3% of women aged between 15 and 49 reported experiencing physical and sexual violence by an intimate partner. Intimate partner within 12-month period during this lockdown. Intimate partner. So what does that mean? Because we have this case of violence, sexual harassment being on the increase during the COVID-19 lockdown.
Definitely, there will be sexual and physical assault on women because our men believe that they are superior more than the women, especially from the intimate partners. Nobody can just wake up and assault you. Most women have reported that their husband do beat them up, do fight them at home, even without any reason. So I think it still goes down to that
education. Whether a husband can really go out there and assault the woman without reason. Because most of the issues that was raised is that because the woman have denied the man sex, maybe that can lead to the man acting, beating up. Now we are talking about physical assault now, because the woman has denied, the wife has denied the husband the sex, and that can lead to...
I think it should not be a problem by if the woman has denied you sex, because it should not be a problem. You have to talk with your wife, your partner. Mm-hmm. It's a matter of You are in a business. Relationship is a business.
Marriage
you
is all about dialogue.
Dialogue
with
thank
a
you.
Woman.
Do the husband need to dialogue?
Yes, with definitely.
Sure, because there is you know, that is why
communication. You communicate with your woman. Oh, my
dear,
I don't like this.
Thank you, madam.
Then because when there is room for communication, then I think all these lapses wouldn't
that
be.
That is why I first say that we have to change the way we have been educated our young man. Because that's when you are not well educated, you will come in a couple whereby you think that you are the superior race.
Do you think it can also be... yes,
if you've seen your father beating your mother, sometimes
that's
you
why
think
I wanted
that,
to come. Do you think it could be
yes,
in that because
yes,
you've grown up to see your father fighting every day with your
you know, if you see
mother.
If you see the way your father is treating your mother,
wait,
you will learn how to treat a lady. But if your father keep telling you that, oh, ladies are no more important, don't mind them, they are just useless, they are places in the kitchen, they have to cook. And you see, the way you grew up with this kind of spirit, anytime your wife want to talk, you say, oh, your place is not there. Even though she want to tell you something serious for children or you are facing a problem in the house.
Yes, Uche, do you think that can play a major impact on this?
Definitely.
Sure.
Definitely, because I believe it starts from somewhere. From a very tender age, a young boy believes that, oh, I am the boss.
Yeah.
But when you, as a mother or a father, so see your son do it like, I am the boss, you have every reason to say, no, you don't do this.
Let me give you an example. Yeah, there's a tribe in Gabon, I don't want to mention. In Gabon, we have a tribe whereby they think that, okay, in our typical tribe, we should have more than one woman. And when you are from this tribe, especially from this part of Gabon, and you don't have more than one woman, you are not a man. You consider yourself as a man because you have two, three. And you are not considered like a womanizer, you are a normal man.
You see? You are not considered as a woman. That is also applicable in some aspect of in some area in Africa.
I'm telling you,
because a man having multiple wives, and that makes you a man.
That
look at the contrary.
That doesn't make you a man. Having multiple women doesn't make you a man. It only shows how, in fact, I don't know how to put it.
But that is not, as he said, because it doesn't make a man lose, because the society itself accepts that.
Uh-huh.
So if I have a multiple wife, it's okay.
Okay, but let me ask you a question. Why are we not proud, or are we not able to accept that a woman should get multiple men too?
That is the society.
The society is not.
The society,
so that means there is a problem with our way of going with issues. If we deal with issues in a certain inequality, we kill the game.
Because as you said, good is a good issue that you have mentioned. Because if a woman has more, if a woman is seen with one man today, another man today, they will say that woman is loose.
Prostitute.
And as we say in Nigeria, see wahala. Because you see a woman having two boys, you say, hey, this one, she's not normal. The judgment comes. But when you see a man having girls and ladies here and there, he has one at Sotega, another one at Louis, Akanda.
Then they clapped for him.
They clapped for him. But when you see this young lady having three boys, hey, this woman, she's dangerous. She's coming with wahala.
So what do you think should be done in the society? Because that is a serious issue in the society. And that leads to all this wife battering, fighting with women here and there. Because we know that is it because the society does not take the woman's right seriously? From the legislation, from the law enforcement, from religious body, even the media as we talk, and culture by itself, it doesn't mean that the woman's right has not been taken very seriously.
First of all, to me, if we want to solve this issue, we should take the two type of people at the same level. I mean, we should consider a woman, we should see a woman the way we see a man. When you look at a woman, you say she has the same right as you, should get the same right as her.
Okay, let me come from this angle, being a weaker vessel, just like the Bible claim we are. I think the man should not, just because of we are weaker vessels, and be superior over us. I think it's high time the men should allow us express ourselves the way it is.
True.
Give us room for expression. Let us say how we feel and how we think things should be done.
I think with that we will come to the end of the of this discussion. We can continue discussing. I think what we have derived from it is that we have to change the mode of our education, and the men should allow the women to express their own feelings. I think with that we have come to the end of the program. Like, thank you very much for coming.
Thank you, Mr. Wede.
Uche.
Thank you, Mr. Wede.
Okay, listeners, I mean viewers, with that, we'll see you next Sunday to discuss more on topical issues that affect us in our society. Thank you for watching.
And more often, women are speechless.